Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Richard Swann, Managing Editor of Oil News in Europe, the Middle East and Africa. In today's edition, we're turning our attention towards natural gas. The international growth in demand for natural gas over the last few years stands in stark contrast to its previous image as the unwanted byproduct of oil exploration. With the relatively clean-burning energy gas provides, compared with the likes of coal or oil, making it an increasingly attractive commodity. However, it would be hard to say that a truly global market for natural gas has yet emerged. This year, prices for natural gas have diverged sharply in the main consuming markets, reaching a disparity rarely seen in any commodity market. With me today to help explain why the price of gas varies so much, and to look ahead at how markets might develop, are William Powell, editor of Platts International Gas Report, and Stuart Elliott, regional editor for Platts Oilgram News. I think we should begin with gas pricing. How can the same basic commodity cost around three times as much in Europe as it does in the US, and about four times as much in Asia? How has this come about?
Well, the real reason has been that the US has now been disconnected from the rest of the world in terms of gas prices because it discovered vast amounts of fairly cheap to produce shale gas. That has turned the US from being a likely major importer of gas, where we are now, to being a country which doesn't actually need the imported gas because it has more of its own, which is cheaper to produce. It has therefore become disconnected from the rest of the world.
Hmm. And the differences in Europe, especially, we haven't seen anything like the gas boom that's happened in the US because of shale. It's not to say it might not come, it might happen. In Poland, they think that they've got huge amounts of shale gas, about 200 TCF of recoverable resources, and they hope to be able to start producing in about 2014, 2015. Ukraine, they think they've got 90-100 TCF. The UK recently said it thinks it has about 200 TCF of shale gas resources. That was a small company called Quadrilla Resources that announced that. And there's also some staggering numbers elsewhere. In Algeria, they think they've got 25,000 TCF gas, shale gas reserves. There's also a problem in Europe because the gas price is linked to the oil price. As we know, in recent years, the oil price has soared. In 2008, it went up to $147 a barrel. This year, again, it's reached nearly $130 a barrel. So the oil price has affected the gas price in Europe, meaning that some utilities buying gas in Europe have had to pay way over the odds and then had to sell on to consumers at a loss.
I get all the supply side issues as well, but what about the demand? Is there a familiar theme here of strong Asian demand, as with many other commodities?
Yes, indeed there is. India and China have both doubled their gas demand in the last 5 or 6 years. And that is because their economies are really, really growing very quickly. Japan has also suffered terribly this year with the tsunami, which took out a lot of its nuclear capacity. And that was also followed by various governmental plans as well to take out plants which are working normally. And that's left Japan with only about 18% of its nameplate capacity in operation at the end of August. And that month also saw Japan's record imports of LNG.
LNG, which you just mentioned, is interesting. Liquefied natural gas, of course. Now, this price disparity has come about at the same time as we've got this tremendous growth in LNG in recent years. LNG production is much more common than it used to be. I thought the theory was that the more LNG was around in the world, the more prices between these different regional markets would converge, not diverge.
Yeah, well, it's interesting to look back first at how LNG has grown. In the last 10 years, it's more than doubled. Production in 2000 was about 100 million tonnes. Last year, it was more than 220 million tonnes. The main historical producers, such as Algeria, Indonesia, Malaysia, they've been joined in recent years by a kind of new batch of entrants into the market, if you like, the likes of Yemen, Oman, Egypt, Norway. Russia actually has its first plant now on the Sakhalin Island in the Far East. They're thinking about increasing the volumes of LNG they produce there and also building another plant in the northern Yamal area of Russia. So yes, there's a lot of LNG due to come on from those areas, also from Australia. They've got lots of new projects due on based on coal bed methane, which is another kind of unconventional gas source. But to get back to your question, yeah, you would have thought that because LNG doesn't have to deal with pipeline constraints, geopolitics a lot of the time, that you would have seen a kind of global gas price or global gas market emerge, but we haven't seen that yet.
I think mainly because each market has its own peculiarities. Mm. The US, as well as having lots of shale, has a vast number of producers. It's a very, very competitive market. In the UK, or Europe, I should say, we have a system where a lot of our gas, maybe a quarter of it comes from Russia, maybe a fifth of it or more comes from Norway, two very big suppliers, and this is what comes in the form of LNG, and the LNG tends to be the spot deliveries. In Asia, though, you have a market which is very much controlled from the wellhead to the burner tip, or from the LNG supply chain. It's contractually much more closely linked together, the various elements of it. It's much easier because there's no competition for the downstream market for a utility to pay what we'd call over the odds for a cargo, because it spread over the cost of its total costs of purchases isn't that big a deal, and it can always claw the money back from its customers. So that people are working in different environments, even though they're all trading in the same commodity.
But nonetheless, if I were an LNG producer, why on earth wouldn't I just ship all my cargoes to Asia, where the price is considerably higher even in Europe and miles higher than in the US? I think I read recently that Atlantic LNG, the project in Trinidad, is still sending a substantial amount of its cargoes to the US. I think the US was still its single biggest customer, more than 20%. Mm. That's a long way down from where it was a few years ago. So it's diverting an awful lot of its production. Yep. But why is it sending anything to the US?
Well, partly because plants need to be kept cold. There are technical reasons, and there are logistical reasons as well. It's not as easy to move LNG around the world as it is to move other commodities such as oil and oil products. It's because of the complication, if you like, which LNG creates. You have very difficult. You have very elaborate contracts. You have a lot of upstream buyers, a lot of downstream. You have a lot of upstream producers, a lot of downstream buyers. There's a lot of contracts. If you want to try to release a cargo from that, that requires a lot of renegotiations to be done. It's all very tightly controlled. Also, you have issues regarding berthing. You have issues regarding gas quality. The Japanese particularly like to have their gas rich with more condensate in it. There are all sorts of reasons why it's not entirely yet fungible.
Also, of course, some of the LNG producers in the world, like Qatargas, they own an LNG import terminal in the UK. They cover the whole chain, so they obviously want to send their LNG to their own terminal. And other producers, Sonatrach, for example, they have capacity rights in the Isle of Grain import terminal in the UK. So there are reasons on that field as well, while they'd want to send it to their own places.
And on the subject of Qatar, they are keen to avoid gas-to-gas competition in Asia, so that's one reason why they're very keen to send cargoes to the north. That ensures that there's less spot cargoes, lowering the price in their traditional markets of Japan and Korea.
Is there a more orthodox kind of shipping bottleneck anywhere? LNG obviously goes on very, very specialised tankers. Mm. We've had tremendous growth in production, as Stuart mentioned, in recent years. Are there enough tankers around to carry this around, or is there a bottleneck there?
Well, if you look at the way day rates have gone up, that suggests that we're reaching the point where people need to build more carriers. 2 years ago, it would be about $40,000 a day. Last year, it was $50,000 a day. Now it's $100,000 a day for a tanker. So there's been a big rise in the cost of shipping. And they've also brought in vessels which used to be called the old ladies. These are the vessels built in the 70s. Which are servicing old contracts, but are still usable, and they come up with a slight discount. But everything seems to be being pressed into service in order to bring the commodity to market.
Now, in the years ahead, we're expecting to see even more rapid growth in LNG production. Some of the countries you mentioned, Stuart, I think are due to bring on stream new projects, and there are new ones coming in addition to those. So what are we going to see here? Can we expect prices to finally start converging and have some kind of global market emerge? Or can we in Europe or in Asia, can we expect to have prices as low as they've got in the US? Or where do we think things are going to head?
Well, I think it's a very difficult game to call, because nobody foresaw the advent of shale gas in the US, and the implications of research done in the UK and Europe suggest that we could be on the brink of a similar kind of upheaval in Europe as well, which would be really quite bad news for companies like Gazprom, who have already decided to postpone various LNG projects of their own. For example, Stockman is now unlikely to go ahead as an LNG project purely because the US, at which the project was pointing, is no longer looking like a viable market.
Also in the US, the huge volumes of shale gas that have been discovered and are being produced now has prompted some companies to look at other ways they can exploit the resource. Gas to liquids is one of those ways. It's a relatively new technology. It produces transport fuels, gasoline, diesel and so on from natural gas directly in a plant. South Africa's Sasol is one of the leading companies in that technology, and last month they said they were going to look to build a new GTL, gas to liquids plant, in Louisiana in the States. It'd be about $10 billion to build, But if you look at the economics of a plant like that, they're fairly startling. A gas price in the US at the moment, $4. That's the equivalent of about $25 for a barrel of oil. And we know that oil is trading for about four times that at the moment. So you can see that companies like Sasol and others would make a tidy profit from making liquids from their natural gas.
And what about, if I could just ask you, what about in Europe? Europe's a very different kind of industry. We've got these long-term contracts. But how do you see that evolving?
Yeah, Europe is a funny fish in that a lot of the big consumers are tied into these long-term contracts, some of which are 25 years, with producers like Gazprom and the Algerians and Norway. And the problem with that is that, as I said earlier, they're being punished for the high oil price. So what they're actually trying to do now, the likes of E.ON and RWE, the German utilities, is they're taking the Russians to court, basically, to try and change the way that the contracts work so that they can and buy more gas on the spot market and less through the long-term contract. So we'll have to wait and see what the result of that arbitration is.
Yeah, it's a fairly risky manoeuvre because, first of all, you've got to bear in mind that oil prices can go down as well as up. And wasn't that long ago that the spot price was way above the oil indexation price? And in winter, you can expect to see spot prices surging because of a lack of maybe pipeline capacity. So you'll have a choke point in the winter months, which could definitely push up the spot price of gas.
But there's always this desire or this long-term kind of theme within the gas industry about we must drop, surely, this link to the oil price. Mm. Gas should be priced against gas, surely, not against oil.
Yeah, that worked in the US, has done for decades, it's been fine. The problem, I think, with Europe, though, as I mentioned earlier, is the US has many, many producers, whereas Europe is very much dependent on the two very large ones, Statoil and Gazprom, and then you've got Algeria, Sonatrach as well. So it'd be much easier for large companies to withhold relatively small amounts of gas from the market in January or February, and they could then sell the gas they did deliver at a much higher price than they would if they delivered their normal, if you like, quota.
So what's the answer there? Do we just continue the status quo, or is there any other possibility?
Well, I think what's going to happen will be a gradual erosion of the element, if you like, of oil indexation. You'll see new entrants coming into the market. They will chip away at the standing order. There's also the likelihood, I think, that if you're a customer buying gas from Gazprom who maybe owns various power plants in Europe, you might think that the power price would be a reasonable thing to fix a price to instead. Gazprom at the moment is in talks with RWE as part of its negotiations over the gas price about acquiring capacity in Europe. And given the vast amounts of gas capacity we'd like to see being built in the power sector, particularly as renewables things takes off, wind, as you know, is famously very, very unreliable. That'll have to be backed up with gas. Why not link the gas price therefore to the power price, which everyone can take a punt on?
Interesting idea. All right, well, thank you both very much for joining me today. I'm afraid that's all we have time for, but that's it for this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse.